Hey guys, welcome back. Today, me and Sim decided to do an episode on habits that might increase longevity. So basically, we have been looking at different studies, correlational studies, that are associating a certain behavior with reduced risk of all-cause mortality.
Yeah, and this is part one. Part two is going to be on my channel, so you can check it out in the description. And part one, we're going to go through three of these things. And in part two, we'll also go through three things linked to longer life.
Yes. So let's start with the first three ones. And basically, I guess a good way to start is actually to define all-cause mortality. So for example, if you have 20% reduced all-cause mortality, that would mean that associated with this behavior, you have 20% less chances of dying at all moments. So we have looked at correlational studies, so I think that's good to acknowledge that these are not causational studies, they haven't made interventions. So usually longevity and mortality risk studies are this kind of correlational studies in which they look at what people have done when they have not died or when they have reduced risk of dying. So the first habit that is strongly associated with reduced risk of mortality is exercise. And there is no reason to doubt this result that exercise
Everyone knows it pretty much.
Yes. And it makes sense. There is logical, physiological explanations. But let's look at the actual studies and the effects of how effective is exercise in reducing mortality risk. There was a big meta-analysis from Zamis et al. 2011, which looked at different results from 80 studies. They had over 1 million participants, so this gives quite good population for the results and makes the study and the meta-analysis pretty robust. So there was a clear dose-dependent association between physical activity and all-cause mortality. They looked at differences between leisure activity, exercises and sports, activities of daily living, transport activities, are basically the activity that you use when you go to, for example, work, and occupational activity. And they found that especially physical exercise and sports, as well as daily living activities, predicted reduced risk of mortality. And it was definitely highest in these two categories, so that with the highest total physical activity and exercise and sports activities, the reduced risk for all-cause mortality was 35%. So 35% lower risk in the high activity group. They also noticed that especially vigorous activity was efficient in reducing the risk of all-cause mortality, and every 60 minutes increases in vigorous exercise per week reduced mortality risk by 9%. They also showed that even moderate intensity exercise was efficient in reducing mortality risk if it were done as longer durations. So for example, 150 minutes, so 2.5 hours about, moderate intensity exercise per week reduced risk of mortality by 14%. Even this kind of leisure, daily living, physical activity was able to reduce the risk of mortality. For example, spending 500 calories per week for leisure activity was associated with 6% reduction in all-cause mortality. So yeah, basically what could be 500 calories from...
Well, that's usually you burn around 100 calories if you do some sort of cardio for, you know, like 15 minutes or something like that, 20 minutes. And if you do like a few times a week of cardio, then you burn 500 calories quite easily. And if you do like an hour long session, then yeah, you're going to probably reach that 500 calories. You don't burn like that much calories with resistance exercise. Like you might burn 100, maybe 150 or 200 at most during one workout with weights. But generally, like cardio, yeah, like an hour of cardio is what you're going to get with 500 calories.
Mm, yeah, so this would be the vigorous exercise. If you wanted to get 500 calories with this leisure daily living activities, that would be several hours of gardening or shoveling
snow. About like five hours of walking. I think like an hour of walking is going to be 100 calories. Something. Yeah. Like.
hour of walking 100 calories. Yeah,
Yeah.
that's a good rule of thumb. There was another study as well, a review that showed that regular physical activity increased life expectancy between 0.4 and even 7 years, up to 7 years. So these studies are very consistent with each other, showing that physical activity does contribute to extended lifespan. Yeah, what are some things that you have found that contribute to this increased lifespan when you exercise?
Well, first of all, I think it just has to do with better metabolic health, insulin sensitivity, weight loss, more muscle tissue, and yeah, just I think it just makes you healthier in terms of your metabolic health, and that just reduces the risk of these chronic metabolic diseases.
Yeah, and exercise is obviously associated also with increased brain growth factors. So when we talk about the Alzheimer's risk, for example, I mean, it increases lactate, it increases beta-hydroxybutyrate, so ketone bodies, and these lead to increased BDNF in the brain, which is the brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which is contributing to the longevity and proliferation and renewal of brain cells. How does physical strength contribute to longer lifespan?
Well, there's many reasons why strength is linked to longevity, and a lot of it has to do with that strength is a, let's say, reflection of muscle mass and muscle tissue, which just means that you have like bigger insulin sensitivity. But strength can also mean, or strength can also help to survive in different kinds of dangerous situations, especially in elderly people. So a lot of times elderly people die to like hip fractures and falling, and if they don't have strength and muscle, you know, explosiveness, then they're not able to hold themselves up and they're gonna more likely fall. Whereas individuals who would have more muscle strength, they're able to like, you know, hold on and not fall on the ground and not break any hip or anything like that.
So it's like exercise for functionality as well, not only for increasing VO2 max or increasing muscle tissue. Okay, so that was it for exercise. The next one is coffee. And coffee is actually linked in many studies for increased lifespan. And not necessarily the caffeine, we will get that shortly, but just drinking coffee. There was a meta-analysis of 40 studies with over 3 million people from 2019, and they showed that the lowest relative risk of dying was when people consumed 3.5 cups of coffee per day. This reduced the all-cause mortality risk by 15%. There was another study, a meta-analysis review article from 2015, and they showed exactly the same numbers. And even 1 cup per day reduced the risk of mortality by 6%.
And I think one recent 2021 study, they found that any type of coffee, like decaf, instant even, and regular ground coffee, they all reduced the all-cause mortality. But the biggest effect was on ground coffee, 2 to 3 cups a day, and that reduced all-cause mortality by 27%.
27. Wow. Okay. That's interesting. Yeah, also, when they have looked at individual causes of mortality, they have noticed that in this 2019 review, they noticed that 2.5 cups a day reduced risk for cardiovascular mortality by 17%, and 2 cups a day for cancer mortality by 4%. This benefit of coffee drinking was irrespective of age, overweight status, alcohol drinking, smoking status, and the caffeine content of coffee that you also talked about, that it didn't matter, was it like a decaf or a full caf, it's probably something else in the coffee that can bring these effects of increased lifespan. Then when we discuss about Alzheimer's risk, it's a little bit more contradictory. So there are studies that show, yes, it effectively reduces Alzheimer's risk, other studies not so much. One article concluded that the studies are somewhat inconsistent, but there seem to be support for the coffee against cognitive decline, and this may be mediated by caffeine or other mechanisms like the antioxidant capacity and increased insulin sensitivity. So we can go now to the why coffee could potentially increase lifespan.
Many of the reasons have to do with the high antioxidant content of coffee. So it's actually one of the biggest sources of antioxidants in the Western diet, and in most people's like life, that's probably the biggest antioxidant source they have. And like coffee also has these different polyphenols in it that help with preventing or protecting against oxidative stress, improving insulin sensitivity, increasing autophagy, and just having this like hormetic effect on the body.
Yeah, I found especially two compounds that were pretty strongly associated with health benefits, especially insulin sensitivity and blood glucose balance, which were chlorogenic acid and diterpenes. And diterpenes were also anti-inflammatory, reduced prostaglandins, which would reduce the general inflammation in the body. So it has basically three effects. It's anti-inflammatory, it's antioxidant, and it's also anti-radical. So it can counteract free radicals directly. And free radicals being these harmful agents that cause oxidative stress in the mitochondria and can decline cellular health. Next, I would like to go into the third one, which might be surprising, but then when we think about it, it's very logical, and it's social support. So there was 2021 meta-analysis, which looked at the results of 23 different reviews and concluded that overall likelihood for all-cause mortality without social support was increased by 11.55%. So basically, if you had social support, the chances are you had 50% less chance of dying, all-cause mortality. And I guess it's important to understand what we mean by social support in the first place. So social support can be social constructs, your relationship, your family relationship, your friends group, your other social groups. It can be the functional support, so how much you receive support, emotional, physical, financial, instrumental, and it can also be the subjective feeling of perceived social support. Do you feel supported, and are you providing support as well? So all of these factors as a whole like make the social support. And there was one specific thing that raised up, which was that being single or widowed or without partner increased mortality risk between 20% and 30%, and for heart disease even for 55%. And one other thing that came up in other studies were that the social support quality and the relationship quality matters more than the quantity. Also, the positive quality of the relationship matters more than just that there are relationships and social support. And also the individual's engagement into the social groups and social relationships matters as well. So pretty convincing evidence for social support as well. Let's discuss the reasons next. What do you think social support does to us?
Well, I think it might lower like cortisol levels and improves just, let's say, well-being, mental health. And I guess like from a psychological side, then being in like social groups or having like peers might make you more likely to, I don't know, stick to healthier lifestyles. Or if you have like some, let's say, you know, importance in terms of staying healthy for others, then you're more likely to, like, you know, not eat that much cake or exercise more or something like that. So yeah, I guess those are the main reasons I think about.
Yeah, definitely, like peer support and this kind of positive role models in reinforcing health behavior is probably very powerful, as well as just the, our, you know, innate human drive to be a social creature. And starting all the way from attachment between mother and a child, like if there is a social support when you are a baby, you develop more resilient nervous system, you are less reactive to stress, you have better coping, and also just the endocrine system develops to be a bit more supportive of health. Of course, there is like the instrumental side. So if you are in a group, there can be reduced financial worry or material worry. So you get like a support from each other. Then there is emotional support. And of course, then there is just the fact that if you get injured, if you fall in the stairs or you get a stroke at home and you have somebody nearby that can support you or call an ambulance in those situations, I mean, that's pretty strongly predictive of your survival. So here we had three habits: exercise, coffee, whether caffeinated or decaf, and social support. And just like a fun comparison, this is like definitely not scientific, but I just wanted to conclude that this actually, based on these studies, social support was the most stronger predictor of an increased lifespan, potentially up to 50%. Right. Then we had regular physical exercise, which were potentially up to 40%, especially for women. And the least most effective, although still increased your lifespan by 15% potentially, was coffee consumption. And the next three habits we are going to review on Siim's channel. Link is in the description. And if you like these topics, make sure to subscribe to the channel and click the notification button so you'll get an email when a new video is out. See you in the next video.